The second day, first session starts with a speaker, Dr. M. Navale, head Swaji Mahavidyalaya, Latur, Maharashtra. He's a good friend of mine. He's going to speak on the topic literature of oppressed today. And I would like to invite the moderator of this session, Dr. M. Natarajan, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Alagappa University, Karaikudi. He has 7 years of teaching experience and he has delivered nearly 6 radio talks. He was accredited gold medal for his PG degree and he has adjudicated 21 PhD thesis and 71 MPhil dissertation. To his credit, he has 27 publications and 3 books as edited volume. He has completed 1 major and 1 minor project. With this introduction, I invite Dr. Natarajan to moderate the session. Over to Dr. Natarajan. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Atrup Satranavakar, sir. Good morning to everybody. Indeed, I deem it a privilege and pleasure to have been asked to welcome Professor eminent scholar and today's research person, Dr. Aravind M. Navale, Professor and Head, Department of English, Shivaji Mahavidyalaya, Udgir, Maharashtra, to this two-day international webinar on contemporary trends in literature organized by the Department of English, Aparachit Thalaivar, Dr. MGR Government Arts and Science College, Madanur, in association with Society for Literature and Culture. At the outset, I'm extremely happy in welcoming the principal, Madam Dr. Uma Mageshwari, and the president of Society for Literature and Culture, Dr. Dayala Krishnan, Assistant Professor and Head, Department of English, Madurai Kamaraj University. Components of higher education, teaching, research, publication, and extension. He has been doing his yeoman service to the teaching learning community for the past 23 years and developed many novel and innovative strategies in teaching and learning. To his credit, he has authored 47 books on socially relevant topics and 45 quality research papers on contemporary issues in the domain of English language and literature in various refereed and EGC listed journals. In addition to that, he has produced 9 PhDs and 5 scholars are currently working under his able research supervision. A fine notable quality which is appreciated by all high profile academicians is publication, which are not only widely read by the scholars, but also cited by international scholars and he acclaimed international repute. It mirrors his erudition and subject competence. Besides, his service to the community is tremendous as he served as NCC officer, as Lost Rank Captain and NSS program coordinator also. Truly, he is a fine humanitarian. It is very rare to see such personality who excels in all parameters of higher education. When I introduce Professor Navale, it is must to highlight his rich administrative responsibilities and experience and also the assignments he has done for the welfare of both the university administration and the student community. He is a member senate of SRTM University, Maharashtra, and he is a taskmaster in designing world-class curriculum as he was given 4 consecutive terms to serve as a member of Board of Studies in English, SRTM University. Professor Navale is really an unparalleled scholar, but we can't find even an iota of intellectual conceit in him. Amidst his tight professional schedule, today he will deliver a lecture on the topic Literature of the Oppressed. I profusely thank and convey my profound gratitude to Professor Navale for having accepted our invitation. I would like to say a few words about the topic, Literature of the Oppressed. A topic is widely discussed in academic forum across the globe. Literature videographs the issues of child labor, child marriage, intercaste marriage, gender bias, male chauvinism, loss of identity, pangs of hunger, paucity of wherewithal, honor killing, blind beliefs, drunkenness, and the belief in supernatural powers of oracle widely prevalent among the Dalits in India and the blacks in America and their victimization in hands of domineering people. These are universal and artistically articulated by the writers here in Burma an iconoclast, a crusader for fighting against the hardship of oppressed and many Afro-American writers. Now we can feel the conducive academic ambience and the climate through the emergence of Dalit literature, not only in India, but across the globe, as it is evident that we can see the fictional aura of Bama prescribed in Western curriculum for revealing the literature of the oppressed. Whereas here in the Indian curriculum, we can see the Western towering figures in the same line. For example, we have that Langston Hughes, we have Mackay, and the list goes. With the emergence of the both writers, both literature, I say, Black literature and the Dalit literature, obtained a special momentum in the realm of global literary scenario. In this great occasion, I warmly welcome a distinguished professor and inspiring academician, Professor Nawale. Now, I hand over the forum to Dr. Nawale. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Natarajan, for such a nice introduction of mine as well as of the topic. Shall I start?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The organizing authorities of today's international webinar on contemporary trends in literature, organized by Department of English, Urachchi Thalavar, Dr. MGR Government Arts and Science College, Madunur, Tamil Nadu, in collaboration with SOLIS, that is Society for Literature and Culture, Tamil Nadu. Dr. B. Uma Maheshwariji, Principal and Organizer. Dr. S. Thirunova Kasuru, Organizing Secretary. Dr. R. Dayal Krishnan, President of Society for Literature and Culture, Madurai. Professor Dr. T. Marks, Pondicherry University. And Dr. S. Prabhahar, Dr. MS University, who are think tanks behind SOLIS as well as this international event. Dr. M. Natarajan, the moderator and chairperson of this session. Dr. A. Ramasubaha, my good friend. And the other team members, technical team, the participants who are accessing this session through Zoom web conferencing rooms, and other who are watching through video streaming, if any. A very good morning to one and all. Friends, in the decade of 1950s, 60s, a new literary movement burst on the Indian literature scene, especially in Marathi language, named Dalit literature. It was initiated by an oppressed group called the Dalit Panthers, which got the spark from the Black movement of contemporary America. This literary movement of suppressed and oppressed class of India, inspired by great thinkers Mahatma Jyotiba Phule and Dr. Bhimrao Baba Ambedkar, and started to get its shape after the death of Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar, an indisputable leader of untouchables and oppressed group of society, and spread all over India. The poets and writers of the movement used the word Dalit, which replaced the earlier names untouchable and Harijan. Although it seemed new to English-speaking world in 1970s, Dalit literature began to appear in every genre as a part of the movement and as a creative and intellectual literary expression of social transformation. It was an outburst of age-old agonies of oppressed group of society who had been socially and economically exploited in India for hundreds of years and emerged as an offshoot of Indian literature and represented an emerging trend in Indian literary scene. Dalit is a term used to address a person belonging to the lower caste. The caste system has an age-old history in India. Written on this system, many were forbidden to exercise their rights in the name of purity and impurity. Dalit literature is a literature written by the Dalits and other oppressed group of society about their lives, about their pains, about their sufferings, about their experiences. This type of literature emerged starting with the Marathi language and soon appeared in Hindi, Kannada, Telugu, Bangla, Tamil, and so on, different languages. Through narratives such as poems, short stories, and mostly autobiographies, which stood out due to their stark portrayal of reality and human justice. Most of the marginalized groups all over the world have a similar system of oppression. So, when they started voicing after centuries of silence about themselves, their human rights, their self-pride, their role in social injustice, chronicles of personal and collective suffering, and hopes and aspirations for a new society which would be devoid of discrimination. Discrimination is the determinant treatment of an individual based on their membership in a certain group or category. It involves the actual behaviors towards groups such as excluding or restricting members of one group from opportunities that are available to other group. They have been treated just like third grade citizens. This bias and discriminatory treatment toward marginal and subaltern groups affect growth of individuals, society, and nation as well. From times immemorial, there has been supremacy of particular power, particular culture, particular gender in this universe. Discriminatory treatment of a vast global population has been justified on the basis of such type of hegemony of caste and color. In most of Asia and Africa, this is the most root cause of discrimination. According to UNICEF and Human Rights Watch, caste and color discrimination affect an estimated 250 million people worldwide. As obvious form of the meaning of Dalit literature, it is the writing about the Dalits and oppressed. This literature echoes the agony of the experience of humiliation, injustice, atrocities, and discrimination excluded by the upper class people on executed by the upper class people on the lower caste people, imposed by them on. The gush in the literature is to expose issues of exploitation, discrimination, malnutrition, and growing death rate of the unprivileged sections of India, like untouchables, minorities, nomadic tribes, vimta jatis, other backward classes, and other degraded lives. It came as a move away from the symbolic grand narratives and posed a tremendous challenge to the existing literary convention and set new trends. The writers of this literary literature or literary type of expressions started contemplating seriously over their problems, the problems of the outcast, downtrodden, enslaved, and untouchables, and urged to make them suitable, equivalent with others, so that they can join the mainstream of a socio-economic, cultural, and modern and civilized society. The cycles of social evils, even in 21st century, have not been broken. On paper, we can remove untouchability, but the centuries-old disgust is still practiced in the society. Who made this inhuman discrimination? This is the core question. And to find answer to it, we have to go to origin of Hindu caste system, which lies in Varna system of Vedic time. The Aryans invaded India and implemented the new law of Varna, resulting in the four classes: Brahmin, the first; the second, Kshatriya; the third, Vaishya; and the fourth and the last one, Shudra. The basic definition and explanations are given that the people engaged in the field of education are Brahmin, the fighters on battlefield are Kshatriya, businessmen are Vaishya, and other rest workers are Shudras. This classification initially seems made on the basis of skills, abilities, and capacities of individuals and their works, which resulted in different caste as per their occupation. But later on, years after, the reality became tragic, with meaning that the class and the caste of father or parental family has been given to their children without examining their occupation, their skill, or their ability to do that work. The origin of the word Chudra, or this discriminatory social order, is found explained in the Purush Sukta of Rigveda, wherein the system has been explained. The hymn 10:19, line 11 and 12 of Purush Sukta of Rigveda describes it as Brahmanasya Mukmasid Bahu Rajanya Krata Uru Tadasya Yadasya Pradya Chudro Ajayat. Chudro Ajayat. The meaning, the Brahmins were his, means the creator or the Purush or the God's mouth. The Kshatriya became his arms. The Vaishyas were his thighs. And Chudras, his, means the creators, the Purushas or the God's pair of feet. In simple term, the concept of Varna states therein that there are four types of human beings in human society. Namely, the Brahmins, who attributes to the head of the Purusha, the creator or the God, and are the educated class. The Kshatriyas, who attributes to the arm and are the ruling or the political class. The Vaishyas, who attribute to the feet of the Purusha or the creator or the God or Manu and are the working serving class. The lowly serf, that is feet, is attributed to Chudras. The Varna system is one, in one sense, could be said to be a good one, in one sense, a good form of the human society, as this classification seems made on the basis of skills, abilities and capacities of the work. For example, the Brahmin would provide knowledge to the society. The Kshatriyas would provide law and order and protect the society, whereas the Vaishyas would provide food and job for the society, and Chudras would provide their service for society as per their skills and capacities, which was needed for the society to run under some rules and work distribution for its progress. In one sense, it can be acceptable. Here, I would like to clear one thing, that I am talking about Brahminism, Brahmin as a Varna and not as a caste. There are some evidences of Varnas which are assigned to people based on their abilities, aptitudes and qualities. For example, Vyasa, a Brahmin sage and the most revered author of many Vedic scriptures, including the Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavat Purana, was the son of Satyavati, a Kshudra Dalit woman. Vyasa's profound knowledge of the Vedic wisdom established him as a Brahmin, even though he was born of a Kshudra mother. The Vedic sage Valmiki was initially a hunter. He came to be known as a Brahmin sage on the basis of his profound knowledge of the scriptures and his authorship of a Ramayana. Even Vishwamitra, born in a Kshatriya family, becomes a sage and hence a Brahmin based on his austerity, knowledge, and character. Janaka, a Kshatriya by birth, attained the rank of Brahmin by virtue of his ripe wisdom and a saintly character, and is considered a Raj Rishi, that is king sage. Vidura, a Brahmin visionary who gave religious and moral instructions to King Dhritarashtra, was born of a woman servant of the palace. His Varna as a Brahmin was determined on the basis of his wisdom and knowledge of scriptures. The original Varna system was quite flexible, in which one's Varna could be changed based on one's skills and was not fixed as it often understood, as per as the evidences I have with me. It seems initially that the system was based on the ability of peoples, but later It is made as based on birth. It is made as, okay, it is made as based on the birth and not on ability of the people, and on account of the hardship quality of this system, Dalits and the Shudras, Atishudras are called the most inferior one, and Brahmin Varnas as the most superior one in the chain of ladder of these four Varnas. In order to greet their own acts, people of the first Brahmin Varna labeled this as caste system and as God made, declining the theory of man-made casteism. Mono, a staunch supporter of Varna and caste system, produced the code in his Manusmriti, and now this has extolled the mind of masses all over the globe and become a part and parcel of man's lifeline. Just look at some of the unjust references found in some man-made religious texts. According to some religious texts, only first three Varnas are considered Aryas. Aryas translated as a noble Arya, that is Ishvaputra by Arya Samaja. The same reference we will get in Nirukta, one of the religious texts. Therefore, Shudras are Anaryas. Arya means son of God. Shudras and other low castes are not sons of gods or the beloved of gods. The people of fourth Varna, that is the Shudra, can't marry a girl from outside his caste. But the people of the first Varna, that is the Brahmin, can marry in the other three castes, also in addition to his own. Similarly, Kshatriya and Vaishya are allowed to marry girls from caste lower than their own, besides from their own caste. It is written in Manusmriti. Among the 10 years boy of first Varna, that is a Brahmin, and a 100 years old person of a second Varna, that is Kshatriya, a 10 years boy of the first Varna, that is a Brahmin, would be considered a more respectable and as a father figure. It is also written in Manusmriti. The maidens, I would like to quote one thing that which is written in Nirukta. The maidens of the dark race are the pre-sexual dishes of Aryan. Look how discriminatory these things are. And this is why 93 years before, in 1927, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar burnt Manusmriti, which entailed the rules preaching inhuman treatment not only toward women but also untouchables in private as well as public sphere. He burnt it as a symbol of rejection of the religious basis of untouchability during his Mahar Satyagraha, which was a fight to assert the untouchables' right to access the public water and to embrace humanity and dignity. As I watched from the film Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, The Untold Truth, the Manusmriti was burnt by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar at the hands of Bapu Saheb Sahasrabuddhe, one of his followers, though he belongs to Brahmin Varna, who said there that even though he is born as a Brahmin, he condemns the doctrines of Manusmriti as it was a symbol not of religion but of inequality, cruelty, and injustice. Even at the present, in the present time too, people of high caste are not ready to eliminate or separate themselves from this system, because if they do so, it will get them down to ground reality. Mahatma Jyotiba Phule, as a pioneer of weaker section in fighting for their liberation against the Brahminism, kept himself outside this culture or this system and created a counterculture based on truth, justice, and humanity. He fought against Brahminism and not Brahmin for itself, as he had a number of Brahmin friends and followers who accepted and shared his ideas of existing reality and assisted him in his efforts to get social justice and equality to the downtrodden. As a founder of Satya Shodak, or a truth seeker, Mahatma Jyotiba Phule's concern thoroughly was concentrated and devoted to the humanity and with value to truth. His social justice was that which assures the dignity of individual. Some Dalit saints too made solid foreground in that time, which helped to rule and to bring equality. It seems Hindu texts like Vedas had the no concept of caste, rather what they had were varnas, a system that categorizes the society based on occupation purely. The varna system thereby gives structure to the society by categorizing it logically and instinctively on occupational line. This classification, which was made on the basis of skills, abilities, and capacities of the work, resulted in different castes as per their occupation later on. But in course of time, the reality became tragic, with meaning that the class and the caste of a father or parental family has been given to their children without examining their occupation, skill, or ability to do that work. In order to greed their own acts and enjoy the privileges, followers of Manusmriti, the people of upper Varna, labeled this as caste system and made by the Almighty Deity, Almighty God. And as white Americans were prevented blacks, that is African American, from living a normal human life because of their race and color, in India, this upper Varna caste people prevented lower caste Dalit, subaltern, marginals, SC, ST, OBC people from living a normal human life and imposed atrocities, injustice, and inhuman life on them since centuries. They were badly and ruthlessly treated in different ways. They were identified by brazen expressions in diverse era and remained the victim of such hideous society, which claims and advocates for their undue liberation from prolonged slavery-like life from time to time on the various issues pertaining to them, resulting their physical as well as mental trauma and their submissiveness, degradation, and annihilation. In reality, caste system, is it God-made? Is the caste system is God-made? What is the politics in representing of Dalit, subaltern, and marginal? Who created this gulf in humans? Who is playing this game? Who is playing this politics since centuries? These are the core questions. And I find answer of these core questions in one of the Marathi poems entitled Veda Aditu Hota. It is a Marathi poem written by prominent Marathi Dalit poet Baburao Bagul. The poem is prescribed to curricula of UGBA course of my university too, and some other universities too. The English translation of this poem can be read like this. I would like to read it. You lived before the birth of the Vedas. You lived before the birth of the Vedas, even before the birth of the Almighty. You means man. Looking at the frightening material world, pained and anxious, you raised your hands and prayed. Those prayers went to make the Vedic verse. It is you who raised your hands and prayed. Those prayers went to make the Vedic verse. It is you who celebrated the birth of all gods and named them happily. Oh, the almighty human, you named the sun and the sun got its identity. You named the moon and the moon got its fame. Only you gave the name to this world and it was accepted with honor. Oh, this the creative, the genuine humans. This is what? The poem written in Marathi and its translation. Baburao Bagul's this outcry exposes hypocrisy and snobbery of upper castes and followers of Manu, who propagated that caste system is God-made and put forth his agonies that everything is made by man. It means everything, Vedas, Puranas, Manusmritis are written by man in the name of the God. Let us see what one saint named Tulsidas writes in Ramacharitmanas. Pujiye vipra jnana gunahina. Vipra, that is upper varna. Pujiye vipra jnana gunahina. Jnana gunahina, without any knowledge, though. Shudrana pujiye jnana pravina. But the subalterns, that is Dalits, the Chudras, Pati Chudras, though they are knowledgeable, though they are virtuous, don't give them that privilege or that respect. It means if people belong to first Varna are knowledgeless, virtueless, you are supposed to worship them. And if people belong to fourth, last Varna of the ladder of Varna system, that is Dalit, though they are gifted with exceptional knowledge, though they are virtuous, they should not be considered worth for such respects. The upper class writers and followers of Manu projected twisted truths and misinterpreted reality in their texts. The literature should accommodate interest of all. How can the literature be mirror of the society or the life if it is biased and discriminatory? India's great cultural heritage is made coupled with a hot, stunning history of human humiliation by some people of upper class in the name of the God. Right from the beginning, Dalit, who by being refused the value of equality, freedom, fraternity, and justice, have been made to lead an animal-like or the human, any inhuman existence in the name of the God, religion, and virtue. The Dalits had to behave according to the laws of Manu. Manu had allotted all dirty work only to lower castes. They were leather workers, scavengers, sweepers, agricultural laborers, or self-cultivators, high caste. Varna always created them as dirt, wrongdoers, sinful, and worthless beings. These Dalits were not allowed to live in their villages. Rather, they had to live in separate colonies outside or the outskirts of the villages. They were banned to enter the public places. They were not permitted to pull water from the public wells and were not allowed to use footwears or the ornaments. They were prohibited to sell goods. Even more, they were restricted to use common burial ground too. The high castes were being polluted by the touch of the Dalits. They were far away from education and were not allowed to hear sacred text. If someone dares to do so, molten lead was used to pour in the ears of the offenders. The Dalits, for one cause or the other, were recurrently kept on the outset of miseries. A number of murderous assaults were continuously bestowed upon them. Because of their acute poverty, many a time they had to sleep with empty stomach. And in order to extinguish the fire of hunger, they had to eat the flesh of the dead animals. So pathetic it was their condition. They were helpless victims of caste catastrophe. Though both Hindus and Dalits were the products of the same nature, Dalits were wiped, harassed, and slain only because of their low caste. Their persistence, alienation, and segregation produced a sense of inferiority in them. Due to their illiteracy, they could not realize their true self for many years. A socio-economical, political, and cultural inferiority was imposed upon them by this higher class varna. Continuous harassment, maltreatment, and hostility shrunken their spirit, frozen their minds, and condensed their skills. As a result of this, they lost their sense of belonging and sense of security. They were uprooted from their socio-cultural beliefs. They lost everything, including selfhood and identity. The word Dalit, in the course of time, has undergone metamorphosis. After the perusal of Mandal Commission report, it became evident that not only untouchables and some tribes, but quite a large chunk of the castes suffer from social, educational, economical, and cultural backwardness. And these castes do carry some traits of Dalitism, though not treated as untouchables. The interpretation of Indian social system by Mahatma Jyotirao Phule was accepted later in 1980s. This interpretation became the hallmark of Dalit writers of post-1980s. Jyotirao Phule described the Indian society comprising two major classes of the caste. The first, upper class, which numerically stands at 15% in the overall population, and the second, Bahujan Samaj, meaning scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, and other backward classes, which form a colossal of 85% in the population. So, clubbing together Chudra and other oppressed castes gave a different nomenclature as Dalit Bahujan in Marathi literary discourse in Maharashtra. Keeping in mind the new nomenclature, a new generation of Dalit Bahujan writers go on contributing to Marathi writings in support of the movement spearheaded from time to time by Jyotirao Phule and Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar in Maharashtra, and Kashiram and other leaders and thinkers in other states of outside the Maharashtra. Though it was so, after centuries, struggle and tremendous protest of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, the emancipator of billions of Dalits and other downtrodden and oppressed caste, they achieved their rights and acquired their social status and dignity. In addition to this, right to education sharpened their intellect, broadened their views, and gave them new vision to look around the world. It enabled them to enlighten themselves. But though they succeeded in breaking down the clutches of slavery and untouchability, the teared wounds of their traumatic past recurrently tortured them. In order to get relief from their sorrowful past, these Dalit Bahujan community writers belonging to oppressed and suppressed SC, ST, NT-OBC castes selected the tool of art and literature to express themselves and to voice their agonies of the past. They produced their own literature, which is called as a Dalit literature. They use the literature to depict their rebel against high caste dominant ideologies and struggle to establish their own identity. Particularly in autobiographies, they presented a very realistic picture of their true self. Thus, in 1960s, inspired by Black movement of America, Mahatma Phule and Dr. Ambedkar, Dalit Ambedkarite literary Dalit Ambedkar literature emerged as a powerful potential force with inspiration of Black movement, Phule and Ambedkar. This literature is not imaginary or recreational literature, but it is a realistic literature. It posed a challenge to existing literary convention and celebrates equality and exhorted strongly to the world that such discrimination should be stopped and it will be no more endured. The purpose of Dalit writing is not beauty of craft, but authenticity of expression of their own expressions, experiences. Most significant attribute is that the Dalit literature displays Dalit consciousness. It is a belief in rebellion against the unjust caste system, recognize the human being as its focal point. Like African-American slave narratives, Dalit narratives are the stories of Dalit victims who endured similar exploitation in their own soil. This literature authentically portrays various forms of social and legal injustices. They use an array of incidents related to injustices in order to educate fellow Dalits. They never celebrate it. There is no fictional theme in Dalit literature, and they do not glorify anything about author's love and romance and fancy and nonsenseness. Dalit literature narrates serious matters, their sufferings, of basic human rights, and longs for their equality as human beings. Just as the literature of Rousseau, Voltaire, or the Karl Marx caused revolutions in their countries, in their soils, in the same way, the writings of Phule, Ambedkar, and their follower Dalit writers called the strong mass movement with which arose the idea of freedom, fraternity, and emancipation from such inhuman clutches of upper class. The prominent writers who voices this are Anna Bhau Sate, Daya Pawar, Raja Dhale, P.I. Sonkambre, Namdev Dasar, Hari Narke, Arun Kambre, Vaman Nimbalkar, Vasant Moon, Amrita Nagar, Lakshman Mane, Lakshman Gayakwad, Sharan Kumar Limbare, Kishore Shantabai Kale, Om Prakash Valmiki, Mano Bhandari, Jay Prakash Kardam, Arundhuti Roy, and many other writers brought out social purpose and criticism rather than mere entertainment in their writing and fought for social equality against unjust social order through their writings. Daya Pawar, who wrote Baluta, a pioneering Marathi Dalit autobiography, which got translated in many languages later on. P.I. Sonkambre, who wrote Athoni Chapakshi, this text, this autobiography too, got translated in number of the languages. Arjun Dangle's Poised Bread, Lakshman Mane's Upra, that got translated as Outsider, or Lakshman Gaikwad's Utsalya, which got translated as Branded in English. Chalan Kumar Limbare's Akkar Masi, which is translated as Outcast, or Kishore Shantabai Kale's Against All Odds, or Om Prakash Valmiki's Zutan, or Bah Mazkur. These writers used their writings as a forum and a medium to voice inhuman experiences of their communities that have been excommunicated, marginalized, exploited, and humiliated for ages in the caste and Hindu society. Let us see some of the touching, moving experts from their writings. Here I would like to read a quote Arjun Dangre from Poisoned Bread. Very touching, very moving expression this is. I would like to read it. The living conditions of these untouchables were simple. They had no land to till, nor could they follow any profession. They did mental work, they did menial work ordered by higher castes. Come rain and shine, treated like animals. They lived apart from the villages and had to accept leftovers from the higher caste people in return to their endless toil. Their physical contact was said to pollute the upper class and upper castes. Even their shadow was said to have the same effect. Hindu religious texts forbade them to wear good clothes or ornaments or even footwear, and prescribed severe and humiliating punishment for violating their orders. Even for a basic necessity like water, they were helpless. They were helplessly dependent on the higher castes and goodwill of higher castes. The most perverted practice of untouchability was that which at one time compelled the untouchables to tie an earthen pot around their necks so that their sputum should not fall to the earth and pollute it. Another was the compulsion to tie a broom behind them so that their footprints would be erased before others set their eyes on them. It is from page number 235 and 6 from Dangle's The Poised World. How moving expression, experience this is. I would like to quote some lines from Lakshman Mane's Usla that is branded. The Lakshman Mane, who is from Dhanegaon of Taluka Latur of my district, just approximately 85 kilometers away from my location. And he wrote Usla in Marathi, later on it got translated as a branded in English, which got Sahitya Akademi Award of Maharashtra. This chapter starts with this expression. It starts on the first page, the very beginning lines. Look, no native place, no birth date, no house or farm, no caste either. That is how I was born. Later on the page number 10, I find one expression which is worth here to quote. I had just started going to school. It was all novel and strange to me. All the urchins started harassing me as if a poor lamb had entered a pack of owls. They threw stones at me because an Uchlia child, that is a branded child, that the child from a branded Pardi Uchlia community had dared come to school. One more expert from it, how police harasses his mother. You harlot, where did you get such a costly sari? Do you have the cash memo for these saris? Means how these community people in general, women in particular, were being harassed by the not only upper caste people, but also the police and administration, how they lived such a pathetic life. I would like to quote also Sharan Kumar Limbare, who has written it. I would like to read it. Rejection and revolt in Dalit literature have been birthed from the womb of Dalit pens. They are directed against an inhuman system that was imposed on them. Just as the anguish expressed in the literature is in the nature of a collective social vice. Similarly, the rejection and the revolt are the social and collective. The Dalit consciousness in Dalit literature is the revolutionary mentality connected with struggle. It is a belief in rebellion against the caste system, recognizing the human being as its focus. Dalit consciousness is an important seed for Dalit literature. It is a separate and distinct form the consciousness of other writers. Dalit literature is defined as unique because of this consciousness. I would like to refer one more writer, that is P.I. Sonkamre, who was a professor of English, who also belongs to my area. Professor P.I. Sonkamre is one of the most prominent first generation writers in Indian Dalit literature. He has very realistically presented his tormented past, humiliation, and struggle to get education and to establish his identity in his autobiography, Athoni Che Pakshi, which is also translated in Hindi and English, also Hindi as Vyadun Ke Panchi, translated by my teacher, Professor Rao. I would like to quote some lines from it. Sometimes a big animal would die, and people, especially Satwa Mali, used to tell me, catch this foot, catch that foot. I would not hold the pit tightly. It would frequently sneak away from my hand and would spatter blood on others. I would always try to save myself from it, because I would think that if the blood prick on my shirt, then the school people would abuse me, and if I could not bring saguti, then my sister would curse me. One more experts from the same Athoni Che Pakshi by Prayi Sonkamre. Women were very bad. Men would tell them to serve me food, but they won't. And if served, they would give a little. Sometimes, due to darkness, it would fall out of the plate on the floor. But I was forced to eat flour, fallen food, for having no option at all. Such pathetic, inhuman, unbearable existence the Dalits experienced, and it's due to the caste hegemony, due to the caste discrimination. One more quote I would like to quote here from Chhauni Hilti Hai, translation, The Contentment Has Begun to Sack, by Arjun Dangle. We fought with cow cross, never even given them the snort from our noses. As we dragged out the upper lane's dead cattle, skinned it neatly, and shared the meat among ourselves. They used to love us then. We warred with jackals, dogs, vultures, kites, because we ate their shares. They have to struggle with, they have to war with jackals, they have to war with dogs, they have to war with vultures, and they have to snatch their shear. How pathetic it is. One more example, Professor Dr. Narendra Jadhav, who rose up to the Vice Chancellor of Pune University later on, and the Member of the Parliament of India. He wrote his autobiography, is a memoir, Outcast Memoir, which is a multi-layered personalized saga of the social metamorphosis of Dalits in India. At one level, it is a loving tribute from a son to his father, But on another level, it gives an intelligent appraisal of the caste system in India and traces the reflective of the aspirations of billions of Dalits in India. I would like to read some lines from it, Outcast, a memoir by Narendra Jadhav. Ah, you bloody Mahari, what do you think you are doing? You have polluted our auspicious food. You fool, who is going to make food for this? That one-eyed father of yours? You scoundrel, your shadow has contaminated the food. It is not fit for eating. Look how Dalit woman, his mother, is humiliated. They use to call them by castes. They are your shadow used to pollute the food. Endurable to us. Some Dalit literature, from times, Dalit literature has been criticized as being propagandist and not artistic due to such realistic language and the words used there and the dialects. It has been alleged that this literature lacks artistic fineness. It has also been charged further that the writing of Dalit writers expresses the frenzy of a moment and does not possess utility or objectivity. But these charges are bottomless and absolutely wrong. The literature should contribute for the social equality, should celebrate the democratic rules and notions, should decast society, should upgrade society with equality. And Dalit literature has done its job well and doing as well. It is not a recreational literature. It is not a literature of leisure. It is not a literature of fancy. It is not a literature of time pass. It is not a literature of romance. It is the real literature, literature of pains. Dalit literature stands as a synonym and encyclopedia of the pains and sufferings endured by the Dalits, because it advocates rights of the oppressed communities and inspires the people to rise against oppression. Dalit literature is a sublime creation which brings about lamentable pains and sufferings and the evolution of personal consciousness beyond human understanding. With the influence of various Western literature, writers of Dalit literature recorded their experienced life stories in order to make awareness among fellow Dalits. They penned their soul-numbing survival stories parallel to American slave narratives and documented suffering as it is. It is meant to bring out positive transmission beyond borders in the contemporary Indian lives of oppressed communities. Their struggle is not for creating violence or anarchy, but it is a struggle for their acceptance as a human being, equal human being with human dignity in democratic India. Though sometimes the literature has been criticized and wrongly represented as being protagonist, overcoming on such criticism, today Dalit literature became a powerful and potential weapon to spread awareness and eradicate social ills. Today, it includes not only the writings about Indian suppressed people, but also other groups throughout the globe that are neglected, deprived, and subsided, and had so secondary position in their society imposed by the privileged classes. This type of literature is labeled with different terms. The term subaltern is used in post-colonial theory. Some thinker use it in a general sense to refer to marginalized groups and the social classes, calling it marginal literature. In this context of naming it Dalit literature or subaltern literature or the marginal literature, these are the complex and controversial terms to explain. As the word Dalit has a large periphery and it speaks about every type of domination that any group faces, this type of literature too might include writings about the exploitation and subordination of the all neglected, deprived and suppressed on account of caste and color hegemony. Rao Saheb Kasbe, an eminent, prominent Dalit thinker from Pune, Maharashtra, says that the term Dalit refers to all those sections of society which are oppressed on account on various reasons. He argues that the term has universal connotations. The term neither exclusively refers to the caste nor can be substitute the term caste. The term Dalit refers to all the exploited people belonging to various lower caste strata of the societies in India. The word Dalit, subaltern and marginal, though complex and different it is, it refers commonly to the people who are oppressed and discriminated because of their lower caste, creed, culture, race, color, gender and religion. So the literature dealing with such oppressed people should not be categorized as a literature produced by those who belong to such particular caste or oppressed category. There are a number of other writers writing on Dalits, but do not belong to Dalit writers category as they are not Dalit by birth as the other writers, Dalit writers are. For example, Mahasweta Devi is there, Sara Joseph is there, Kumar Sen is, Mulkaraj Anand is there, Premchand is there, and so on. These are the well-known names writing in diverse Indian languages and voices the hopes and aspirations of the exploited masses and Dalits. Their writing too deal with the oppression, suffering, psychological turmoil of oppressed social group. Their fight for survival, their daily problems, the insults they have to put up with, their experiences and their outlook towards all these events, but projected by them in their texts. I do agree that Dalit pens written by non-Dalit seems a bit as sympathetic attempts as they are not innate part of the exploitation or victimization or the victimized masses of the caste system. No doubt, I do agree. Till such literature too should be accommodated in the category of literature of oppression. So, the literature which can be produced by anyone who believes in human values, human dignities, as Dalit literature or the African American black literature, which reflects the striving of such people to gain their self-respect, dignity as a human being, may be called as a literature of oppression. You should not be casteist literature at all. What should be human literature? It can be produced by anyone who believes in humanity, human values and dignity, who believes in Dr. Ambedkar's thoughts, Mahatma Phule's thoughts. This literature of oppressed should reflect the striving of such people to gain their self-respect, dignity as a human being equal to other all human beings. So, commonly, such literature may be called as a literature of oppression, as I already said. as it is the literature of pain, suffering, agonies, and protest. It has emerged as a thought-provoking, ever-widening branch of literature in recent decades. It deals with oppression, suffering, psychological turmoils, shades of the backwardness, fulfillment of the human needs, an appeal to be treated with equal dignity as equal human beings without any sorts of discrimination. This literature is contributing to decaste society and upgrading society with equity. This literature emerged as a radical literature and challenged the norms, standards, and principles of the so-called mainstream literature, aesthetics, and literary theories. It is not the literature of mere protest and negation. It aims at dismantling the existing structure of explanation and restructuring the society, not on Indian level, but the global level. Thank you for giving me an opportunity.